Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Once in a Blue Moon Lodge, a novel by Lorna Landvik, read by Anne Marie Lee. Prologue. On the day my grandmother got arrested, I found out I was pregnant with triplets. Yikes. Knowing there was no way to alter its pass-fail grade with extra credit, I was lightheaded and sweaty taking the home pregnancy test, and when the wand's little plus sign glowed, indicating my passing mark, I sat slumped on the edge of the tub, feeling a roiling mixture of terror and glee. I had long wanted to start a family, but I wanted one the old-fashioned way, married to the dad, the two of us united in love for each other, as well as our upcoming bundle of joy. As it was, the baby's father and I had been united, but only once, in a sleeping bag that smelled of fried trout and wood smoke. 2 days after my home test result, I visited the gynecologist, who breathed in a little gasp as she looked at the fuzzy sonogram screen. No matter the size, a gasp is generally not something you want to hear coming out of the mouth of your healthcare professional. When she described the blurry shadows, I gasped. Turns out that bundle of joy was plural. "Hey, Nora, meet the jailbird," said Patty Jane as I staggered into the kitchen, the rug, the floor, the earth itself having just been yanked out from under me. "Jailbird," scoffed my grandmother. "We weren't behind bars. They just had us in a little room." Ione says Krabby's only regret was that the arresting officer didn't frisk her. "Yeah, she said he reminded her of the first boy she ever kissed." Shaking her head, my mother said, "Imagine the damage inflicted on that poor guy." Their conversation was not helping my rising discombobulation, and I reached for the most used appliance in our household, the coffee pot. After pouring myself a cup, I sat down at the table and asked them to kindly give me a clue as to what they were talking about. "Nora, today was the gun shop sit-in, remember?" said Grandma, in the light Norwegian accent that turned her sentences into little songs. "And we got arrested for trespassing." Not content to be a master grandmother, Ione was a founder of OBFC, Old Bags for Change, a group of seniors whose goals were no less lofty than worldwide peace and justice for all. Still, she found time in her rabble-rousing to bake, and it was a plate of her most recent offering, thin as brittle sugar cookies, that she pushed in my direction. "Nora, what's wrong?" asked Patty Jane when I failed to help myself to that which I usually found irresistible. I stared into my cup with the intensity of a tea leaf reader, but no answers were revealed, as it was filled with coffee. Knowing there was no other way to say what I had to say than to say it, I sighed as heavily as a convict at another denied parole meeting. "I'm expecting triplets." "Triplets of what?" said Patty Jane, helping herself to a cookie. "Triplets of babies." There was an odd flurry in the air, as if the molecules and atoms had been stirred up, and for a brief moment we were taken outside of that cheerful kitchen and into another dimension where time stood still and space swirled. "Whose babies?" asked Patty Jane, the hand that had taken a cookie frozen in air. "Mine," I said. "I'm pregnant with triplets." Palms splayed across her chest, my grandmother whispered a fervent, "Uftameda." There's no real translation for her favorite phrase. Depending on its emphasis, it could be as mild as, oh my, or as explicit as any curse word. Ione never swore, but in this case the inference was there. Patty Jane, however, never bothered with inference. Holy shit, Nora! Remembering that long ago day, I write, family stories shouldn't be treated like heirloom china or antique ornaments, carefully wrapped in tissue paper to be brought out only for holiday display. They're meant for everyday use, like favorite recipes or faded patchwork quilts. Stained or torn, they offer sustenance and comfort. I drum my pencil furiously on the paper, pockmarking it with graphite. My goal is to compile a book of family stories for my girl's 18th birthday, but I've crossed out as many words as I've left in. Recalling the thrilling and scary day the gynecologist told me I was carrying a trio has made me wonder. How much do I leave in, and how much of the story do I leave out? Sana would prefer the unabridged version, complete with interviews, footnotes, and graphics. Grace would like only those tales featuring love and truth and harmony, but I'd like to offer them something a little bigger than a brochure. Ulu would encourage me to mine for the jokes, or failing that, to sex it up. I read what I've just written to my mother. "Very nice," she says, looking at me through her sunglasses. "But I don't get it." "What do you mean you don't get it?" "Well, we've never treated our family stories like heirloom china or old ornaments. Antique. Antique ornaments," I say, miffed, because I know she's right. "And it isn't as if you've hidden much from the girls, just as I hope I never hid much from you. Just as Grandma never hid..." "Oh, wait," I say, and we both laugh. It's a beautiful June afternoon, and we're out on the deck, facing the ocean, which glitters with sunshine. Lounging beside me on a chaise longue, my mother looks like a cover girl, and I tell her so. "Yeah, right. For AARP, maybe." She adjusts her sun hat. In the battle against gray, Patty Jane is a soldier who has never fallen, and I know she wants to protect her latest dye job. Looking back at the words on my legal pad, I sigh and write, "In our family, strangeness, while not necessarily the rule, is not necessarily the exception either." When I share this insight with my mother, she hoots. "Well, what do you expect? You're telling stories about a family." "It'd just be easier if ours were a little more normal." "Well, you know what Tolstoy said? All normal families are alike. Each abnormal family is nuts in its own way." "Good one, Ma. I'm sure he'd appreciate the new translation." She shrugs. "I never really understood the original quote. Why does he think that all happy families are alike, but unhappy ones are unique in their unhappiness? Isn't it all sort of fluid? A happy family on a Wednesday can be miserable as hell by the weekend." "So you think I should write about everything? Uncensored?" Pushing down her sunglasses, my mother raises one eyebrow. "Right," I say. "You're the last person I should ask about censoring oneself." "Just tell whatever you want to tell in whatever way you want to tell it." "But how do I start?" I ask, my voice skipping back a few decades to reclaim an attractive prepubescent whine. Tapping her chin, Patty Jane looks out at the sparkling water. "How about... last night I dreamt I went to Manderley again." Hearing my sigh, she adds, "Okay, then what about... it was the best of times, it was the worst of times. Thanks a lot, Mom.
You know me, she says, leaning back on the chaise longue and offering herself up to the afternoon sun. Always happy to help. I drum my pencil on the legal pad once, twice, 3,000 times. Leave it to Dickens to have already used a line that perfectly summed up practically anyone's story, including ours. It really was the best of times and the worst of times. Part 1. Chapter 1. Winter 1988. Patty Jane Rolvaag was middle-aged, and though she had lived through enough drama to fuel a hit Broadway show, she was lovely, without the qualifiers still or for her age. The swaggering co-host of Babs and Boyd in the Morning certainly thought so, putting moves on her more appropriate at a singles bar than in a television studio. That Boyd Burrows was a former football player and sportscaster out of his element when interviewing anyone who didn't wear a helmet or jockstrap was immaterial. Bad manners were bad manners. There'll be a lot of sniffles when this beloved neighborhood institution closes its doors at the end of the year, he said, reading the teleprompter copy. Yes, it'll soon be the end of both pin curls and programs at Patty Jane's House of Curl, etc. The unique salon within a salon, a place where the client's interior gets as much attention as her exterior. The hulking man, whose brawn tested the seams of his Italian-made suit, turned away from the camera and aimed his killer white smile at his guest. I have no idea what a salon within a salon is, but let's meet its proprietor, who I have to say has taken pretty good care of her exterior. Punctuating his words with a little wink, he added, Welcome to the show, Patty Jane. Returning his wink, Patty Jane said, Thanks, Boyd. And in her head she added, You big ape. To her staff and clientele, tuning in to the show's popular Neighborhood Legends segment, the announcement of the closing of the House of Curl, etc., was no surprise, having been advised of it by Patty Jane weeks earlier. They had reacted with tears, pleas to reconsider, and in Krabby Boltram's case, threats to sabotage its sale by telling any prospective buyers that A. The smell of permanent wave solution was indeed permanent, embedded in the walls and especially noticeable on hot summer days. B. The property was one termite bite away from collapse, or C. The place was cursed. There was no truth to A and B, and Patty Jane had been quick to correct C. Had been. The always prepared and professional half of Babs and Boyd, felled by a sudden flu, had called in sick that morning, leaving Patty Jane to deal with the half whose preference was to wing it. As usual, Boyd Burrows hadn't read his prep sheet, and as Patty Jane tried to tell the story of the House of Curl, etc., he constantly interrupted her. What? It all started when your husband Thor went missing? Yes, and with him gone, I had to figure out a way to make money, so I opened Patty Jane's House of Curl and operated it out of my home. I thought it was Patty Jane's House of Curl, etc., said Boyd, in a tone suggesting his guest was confused. We added etc. to the name when we had the opportunity, many years later, to move the salon into a much bigger place. Knowing that she would need a lot longer than her 5-minute allotment to explain the admittedly strange and complicated history of her salon, Patty Jane instead changed tack and began listing some of the events the etc. had hosted. We've had musical and dance recitals, talks given by everyone from an astronaut to a zoologist. What? An astronaut gave a talk in your beauty parlor? Our lecture and performance series has attracted a wide range of interesting people.
Yeah, but wouldn't that sort of be a come down for an astronaut to speak in front of a bunch of ladies getting their hair done?
We don't hold the events in the actual beauty salon, said Patty Jane, keeping her voice light and forcing her eyeballs not to roll. The House of Curl, etc., has different rooms for those. Finally, Boyd Burroughs gave up, deciding to focus on that which he knew he understood, seduction, proceeding to make suggestive comments about beauty operators and wanting to be swiveled in your chair. But when he leaned into Patty Jane, asking if she'd like to run her fingers through his hair, she said, "No thanks, but I wouldn't mind putting my hands around your neck."
"That was priceless," said Paige Larkin, who'd watched the live broadcast that morning. "The look on his face."
Patty Jane shook her head. "And get this, off the air, he still asks me out to dinner."
"No."
"What did you say?" "I said I make it a point to never dine with patronizing pinstriped TV show dumbasses who give lousy, unprepared interviews and then try to pick up their guests." The cold air turned Paige's chortle into a stutter of vaporous clouds. "At least you're laughing," said Patty Jane, taking her friend's arm.
"That's good."
A gust of icy wind blew Paige's thin cashmere coat against her legs. Even in freezing weather, she saw no reason to abandon style, and besides, both menopause and the rage she felt toward her philandering husband were a combination that worked to keep her body temperature set on high.
"I thought I had learned how to live with humiliation," Paige said. But when he got together with this one, it was just too much.
He was her husband, Spencer Larkin, and this one was a 24-year-old employee at their country club.
"She wasn't even that good a waitress. She would always get my order wrong, and yet there Spence'd be tipping her 30%.
The two women walked up to Lake Street, crossed the bridge to St. Paul, and followed the river south, and by the time they'd gone over the Ford Bridge back to Minneapolis, Paige, whose monologue had been punctuated by everything from tears to vitriol, felt as if she'd been in a deep and productive therapy session. Patty Jane felt in need of a strong cup of coffee with a brownie chaser. Back home, on a November afternoon whose gloom had settled in as both color and mood, Patty Jane stood leaning against a doorframe, not seeing the forest of birdhouses displayed in the rectangular space, but what had filled the room years ago: the rinse sinks, the hair dryers, her sister's harp. Harriet had been dead for nearly 20 years. But there were still moments when an aching loneliness spread through Patty Jane like an emotional rheumatism. It had been Paige's parting remarks that had ignited a memory triggering this flare-up of sadness.
"And now to find out Spence and his girlfriend have been using our family's cabin as their love nest? How could they? That was my refuge."
Tens of thousands of Minnesotans own these refuges, with many of them passed down through generations. But there was no deed to a lakeside cabin in Patty Jane's family. Her parents' worldly possessions were few at their deaths, both related to decades-long alcoholism, and their orphaned daughters had had the sad task of picking through the Dobbins' meager estate.
"If empties were money,"
Patty Jane said as they cleaned up the tiny kitchen, "we'd be zillionaires." Anna had outlived Elmo by only 4 months, and by the vast collection of beer and gin bottles, it appeared she had been drinking with the goal of joining him as fast as she could.
Poor Ma, said Harriet.
Poor is right.
The sympathy coloring her sister's voice was not present in her own. Patty Jane was not cold-hearted. She had loved her parents, but knew they had willingly taken up the shovels that dug their own ditches and used others' sympathy as an excuse to keep digging rather than as a ladder to help themselves climb out. Years later, when Harriet fell into her own alcoholic morass, experience had taught Patty Jane that while she could extend a helping hand, she couldn't force her sister to grab hold of it. Family vacations had been few and far between. Parents who like to escape in drunken fogs rarely have the impetus or energy to take trips that involve more planning than figuring out whose turn it is to go to the liquor store. But one summer, the Dobbins had managed to make the drive up to a small family-owned resort on Lake Osakis. For 2 days of bliss, Patty Jane and Harriet were regular kids with regular parents who dove off an old wooden dock and paddled around in a dented aluminum canoe and batted a birdie over a sagging badminton net. The first night, they went into town for drive-in hamburgers. The second night, after the sun settled into its pink and red blanket, they roasted marshmallows, although the girls, impatient, blistered them black and sang songs around the campfire. The voices of Patty Jane and Elmo were serviceable, but it was obvious that Harriet's musical genius was fruit plucked from her mother's side of the family tree. When the two of them began singing Home on the Range, Patty Jane thought, "There's no family I'd rather be in than this one." It was an unfamiliar sentiment, but its truth filled her with a calm and complete happiness. Leaning against her father's shoulder, she looked across the campfire, watching the leaping stalagmites of flame light her mother's and sister's faces. Anna and Harriet played with the harmony, tossing it back and forth as if it were a toy. The long light of summer had waned into darkness, and the lake behind them was invisible to the eye, but not to the nose, smelling pine-tinged and fishy.
"How about you are my sunshine?" called out a voice from a nearby cabin.
"They've already got a fan club,"
whispered Elmo to Patty Jane as the singers honored the stranger's request. When they were done, another voice called out,
"How about Sentimental Journey?"
And after they'd sung that, another voice asked for "The Man I Love." After a whispered conference, Anna called out,
"My daughter doesn't know the lyrics to that one, but here's one for you."
And the two launched into the campfire classic, Red River Valley. Hours later, the sound of breaking glass was an ugly coda to the evening of music.
"Good one," said Anna,
her lovely singing voice now thick and coarsened with drink.
"Shut up," said Elmo. "Shut up and give me another one."
"Patty Jane," whispered Harriet, fear ripping away the gauze of sleep. "Patty Jane, are they?"
"Yes,"
she answered, and in the narrow log-framed bed they shared in the dark rental cabin, the sisters held each other, their puny armor against what raged outside. More interior sulk and ruminate drunks, the girls' parents rarely fought. But that night had them screaming and yelling, and people in the other cabins, those who hours earlier had thanked Anna and Harriet for the lovely concert, were now screaming and yelling back.
"Shut up!
Go to bed and sleep it off!
What's the matter with you?
These are family cabins!"
Elmo, who, sober, had the soul of a gentle man, got into a fist fight with a vacationing pipe fitter from Eau Claire, a fight he lost which left him with a bloody nose and a shiner that would swell so that his eye was a mere slit in a ripe purple plum. The resort owner broke up the fight, and the family Dobbin was forced to leave the next morning. Anna and Elmo hung over and miserable. Patty Jane and Harriet just miserable.
"Mom? Jesus Christ," said Patty Jane. "Don't sneak up on me."
"Ma, it's not like I tiptoed in."
Nora gestured to the clogs she was wearing. "Anyway, sorry." Copying her mother's pose, she leaned against the other side of the doorframe and folded her arms across her chest.
"So, neighborhood legend, I taped your segment. You want to watch it?"
"No. I'm in a lousy enough mood as it is."
"Oh, Ma, of course you are. You announced on national, well, local TV that we're closing down. That makes it official."
"Yeah, I guess. Are you having second thoughts?"
"Maybe third and fourth thoughts," said Patty Jane, her mouth lifting in more a shrug than a smile.
"But no, it's the right time."
"So you're in a bad mood because..."
"Oh, it was just something Paige said about her family cabin being her refuge. It made me think about the one time our parents took Harriet and me to this little resort."
Aware of her mother's fractious childhood, Nora said,
"Well, that sounds nice."
"Hanson's Haven," said Patty Jane, brightening as she remembered the resort's name. "And it was nice, till it wasn't. And then you know how it is. One thought leads to another, and suddenly..."
Patty Jane nodded to a corner of the room.
"I'm seeing Harriet sitting over there, playing the beer barrel polka for Gudrun's birthday request."
"Oh, I remember those. She played Last Train to Clarksville for my 12th birthday. I doubt there are many harpists who play the monkeys.
Or the beer barrel polka."
Patty Jane's chest lifted and fell in a deep sigh, but it signaled a finale to her gloom, not its continuation. She was equipped with an internal alarm that sounded when emotions threatened to get out of control, or in this case, when sadness needed to be turned off before it soured into moping.
"Say, did you see this?"
Taking her daughter's hand, Patty Jane led her into the maze of birdhouses.
"Your dad just brought it up. It's a replica of the IDS tower. And look, it's even got a lobby."
Nora traced the lines of the miniature bird skyscraper.
"Incredible."
The word, along with other adjectives like amazing or exquisite, was often used to describe the craftsmanship and imagination of Thor Rolvaag's birdhouses.
"I know. He just keeps getting better and better."
If the look mother and daughter exchanged were a fragrance, it would have a top note of wonder, a middle note of love, and a bass note of sorrow.
"Hey," said Patty Jane, "I was so busy fending off that ignorant lecher on TV, I can't even remember if I mentioned what's happening tonight."
"You didn't," said Nora, "but we've already got about 50 people coming."
"Good.
Are you?"
"I wasn't planning to. I thought I'd..."
"Oh, come on," said Patty Jane. "It'll be fun."
Chapter 2.
The tango. Ah, the tango. It is all about desire. It is all about passion. It is all about control, said the man whose oily black hair was serrated with comb marks. "But whose control?" asked his partner,
whose sharp, angular eyebrows gave her an unwavering look of disdain.
Is it the man or the woman who is in control?
I would have to say, whispered Patty Jane, imitating the dancer's accent, that in their case, it is definitely the woman.
At the couple's nod, Inky Kolstad punched the play button, and the dancers began to follow the tape's slow and slinky music. In the calendar of events, it had been listed as a night of tango, and all comers were urged to help us welcome Franco and Vilma Sergovia, international tango stars, as they finished their world tour by heating up the floor at Patty Jane's House of Curl, etc. It didn't matter to anyone in the audience that the Sergovia's world tour had only consisted of stops in Fargo, Billings, Boise, and Bozeman. What counted was that 38 women and 11 men in attendance were being transported to a world of steamy Argentinian sex and intrigue. Near the end of their performance, when the couple recruited volunteers, cheers rose as Thor took the hand Vilma extended to him.
Oh boy, thought Nora, watching her father.
Uf da meda, thought Ione, watching her son.
Mother of God, thought Patty Jane, watching her husband in name only. Franco and Vilma Sergovia knew this was a crowd favorite. Plucking from the audience willing dance partners, and they had formulated a winning strategy. Franco, after appearing to carefully deliberate, would choose a woman who most likely spent her high school dances wilting against the wall, while Vilma would zero in on the most attractive man in the audience. Sitting together was a contingent of women who had been clients of Patty Jane's House of Curl since its inception. And while they still came to get their now grayer and thinner hair styled at the etc., they considered the true salon to be the one that extended pampering to their minds and souls. For years, women having their hair cut or curled in the day might return in the evening and give their attention to hobbyists, enthusiasts, and the occasional expert who offered insights into Puccini's operas or Icelandic folk art or the easiest way to butterfly a butt roast. Inky, a dedicated fan of Hollywood, had been one of the first to take the leap from customer to instructor, and had held lectures on subjects ranging from Ronald Reagan's oeuvre to female second bananas in comedy, from Patsy Kelly to Vivian Vance. Growing up, Nora had been privy to many of Inky's lectures, and she returned home after her stay in Los Angeles to the woman's wrath.
Nora! You were in Hollywood! You were living everyone's dream!
Inky, I was drawing up contracts about ancillary rights and production credits. It wasn't like I was a movie star.
But you could have been, said Inky, who told anyone willing to listen that Nora Rolvaag was in a league with her favorite leading ladies, Rita Hayworth and Debbie Reynolds.
The Hollywood expert sat next to Dixie Anderson, who that morning had dyed Inky's wispy hair a Rhonda Fleming red, as per her client's instruction. Dixie had been one of the first to stand behind a beautician's chair with Patty Jane, and she still styled hair, albeit on a shortened schedule due to arthritis that had squatted uninvited in her knees and fingers. Next to her was Crabby Bultram, a woman still cranky enough to be deserving of her nickname.
A man can say anything and he's respected for his honesty, she had said long ago. If I were a man, you can bet they never would have called me crabby.
No, Patty Jane demurred. I'm pretty sure they would have. Paige Larkin sat next to her friend Marvel Stang. Marvel wondered what Paige, whose children were as slim and blonde and elegant as their mother, thought about her own daughter Elise, who Marvel had dragged along to the dance exhibition with the unspoken admonition that it sure beats sitting around eating me out of house and home. Elise and her two children had moved back home after a divorce, and even though Marvel was enamored of her grandkids, she couldn't wait for the day when cartoons didn't blast the morning quiet to smithereens, couldn't wait not to break up fights based on whether Jacob got a smear more peanut butter on his toast than Caitlin, or whether Caitlin had indeed flushed one of Jacob's Legos down the toilet. Couldn't wait for what she and Earl had rightfully thought they had earned, a little peace and quiet. Still, it hurt her deeply to hear Elise crying behind the closed door of her old bedroom, still decorated with her high school gymnastics trophies, her cheerleading pom-poms, and Sean Cassidy posters. To see her attack the contents of the refrigerator and pantry as if she were not only famished but angry. To overhear anguished phone calls to her best friend in which she bemoaned, 31 years old, and my life is over. Now, when the tango dancer with the 5 darkening to 6 o'clock shadow held out his hand, Elise wanted to shut her eyes and will him away. But her mother was poking her so hard that she was willing to risk public humiliation just to escape that spleen-bruising elbow. Tugging at the ribbed hem of her sweatshirt, Elise blushed furiously as Franco led her to the front of the room. She still hadn't lost her baby weight, never mind that her baby had just started kindergarten, and in fact had compounded interest on it. On the small platform that served as a stage, the professional couple demonstrated a few steps before holding their arms out to the amateurs. Elise flushed again, and Thor, watching Franco, adjusted his posture, cocking his elbow higher.
"Very good," said Vilma.
She had been prepared to flirt outrageously with this handsome man, but up close, she could see in his blue eyes an odd blankness. If eyes indeed were the windows to the soul, this hombre had pulled down the shades.
"I'm dancing with an imbecile," she thought. "Franco's got a whale in his arm, and I've got an imbecile."
"Again," Franco said, and together he and Vilma, leading their partners, instructed them to step slow, slow, quick, quick, slow.
They rehearsed their steps several times, and Franco would later tell Vilma that at first he felt he was pushing around a tree stump, but after he cued the old woman with the flaming red hair to start the music, something loosened in his heavy, resistant partner.
"I am telling you, Vilma, I could feel the change instantly, and I thought, Dios mio, I could really teach this one something."
It was true. When Inky started the music and Elise felt the pressure of Franco's hand on her back, she thought, "What the hell? I've got rhythm. I used to be a gymnast. I'm not how I look." Her eyes met her teacher's and returned their intense stare, and the couple began moving around the stage in sensuous syncopation. You could have hit Marvel over the head with a tap shoe. She stared at her daughter, seeing the beauty and grace Elise kept hidden under all that fat and hurt.
"Mercy," she whispered.
For these demonstrations, it was easier if Vilma took over the man's role and led, and Thor too easily followed his partner. His jaunty movement was more suitable for the foxtrot than the tango, but he never once stepped on Vilma's toe.
a rare and much appreciated gift to a dance teacher. Feeling guilty that she had misjudged him, Vilma whispered into his ear words of instruction and encouragement. When the exposition was over, both couples curtsied and bowed, and the audience rose in a standing ovation. Thor grinned and bowed again, and when the audience laughed, he bowed a third time.
Thank you very much, said Franco, subtly directing Thor and Elise off the stage.
It was he and Vilma, after all, who were the stars of the show, and they preferred to take their final bows alone.
Thank you, he said, as Vilma threw a kiss to the crowd. Thank you for letting us bring you the beauty of the dance.
Any worthwhile cookbook compiled by a PTA or church circle has its 7-layer bars recipe, but Ione was never one to submit to the authority of written instructions and had upped the ante, adding an extra layer to her bars. A small crowd had gathered near the coffee urn, eager to dig into them, and when they ran out, the store-bought Ladyfingers Inky had supplied. Refreshments were always served after a lecture or performance, which inclined people to stay around and talk about what they had seen or heard. Now wistfulness colored the discussions, knowing that nights like the one they'd just experienced were coming to an end. A knot of women stood reminiscing about the time a magician had asked for a volunteer to saw in half, and the audience, in loud unison, had elected Krabby. Brushing past them, Nora said, Elise, you were wonderful! Thanks, said Elise, eyeing the square bar perched on a napkin in Nora's palm and filled with everything she loved. Chocolate, caramel, coconut. Usually she would have been the first in line, the first to have seconds, and the first to have thirds. But she happened to shift her gaze to see Vilma slip, with the same sinewy grace she had shown on the dance floor, into the coat Franco held open for her. I'd like to slip into a coat like that, she thought. A coat held open by a man who wants me. For the first time in recent memory, Elise Stang McIntyre declined an offered dessert and instead just had coffee. Back home, Nora marveled at her father's star turn on the dance floor. Really? She said, setting the flat white box in the middle of the table. Who knew you were so smooth on your feet, Dad? I knew he could dance, said Patty Jane. We cut up the floor a few times, remember, Thor? A puzzled smile answered her question. No, he did not. Both the idiom and the memory escaped him. Nora chuckled as she served her dad a slice of cold pizza. Tonight will go down as an etc. classic. Ione nodded.
Yeah, watching Thor tango.
Oh my, it was better than hearing Millie yodel. Patty Jane laughed, remembering Gudrun's cousin visiting from Austria, who long ago had given a room full of women a lesson in the art of alpine yodeling. Well, if you're going to go that far back, how about when we had that yoga demonstration and Krabby got stuck in downward dog? I am so glad I wasn't there to see that, said Nora. She had her knees locked up, said Ione. It took three of us to get her out of it. Having bitten into his pizza, Thor chewed for a moment and swallowed, staring up at the ceiling. He wiped his mouth with one hand, and with the pizza slice drooping in his other, he said,
El tango no está en los pies, está en el corazón.
Nora looked to her mother, who looked to her mother-in-law.
Ever since Thor's return many years ago, these exchanged looks of surprise had been commonplace.
"Did you hear that?" asked Patty Jane. "Did he just speak Spanish?"
"It sure wasn't Norwegian," said Ione.
"What did he say, Nora?"
asked Patty Jane. Her high school and college Spanish had gotten much better after having lived in L.A., thanks to a friendship Nora developed with her next-door neighbor, who was originally from Oaxaca. The two walked early every morning in nearby Bronson Canyon Park, and Maria Elena was happy to oblige her friend's request to "Habla español, por favor." Wanting to be sure she had heard her father correctly, Nora asked Thor to repeat what he said, and after he complied, she smiled. He said, "Tango is not in the feet, it is in the heart."
Chapter 3. Her energy drained after taping up a box of legal files, Nora sagged into her leather swivel chair, and the bad mood that had been nipping at her heels jumped up and flopped its mangy self square onto her lap. She had been taught by example that the best antidote to brooding was action. But rather than boosting her spirits, the act of packing up her etc. office was only deflating them. Buyer interest had increased tenfold after Patty Jane's television appearance, and after weighing several offers, she had accepted one, with plans to be out by the new year. Change was in the air, but Nora's impulse was to open a window and let it out. Pieces of mail fanned across her desk. The day's delivery had included three letters from etc. clients expressing everything from gratitude, "The class I took on flower arranging started my career," to petulance, "Now where am I supposed to get my highlights done?" to hyperbole, from enlightenment and engagement to emptiness. But it was her law school's biannual newsletter and a wedding invitation that had further stirred the stew of her discontent. Her old roommate, Pam Gregory, having recently won an acquittal for a hedge fund manager in a sensational televised trial, he even bilked his doorman, was featured on the front of the newsletter. Under a photograph of Pam wearing a designer business suit and a severe but flattering chignon was a quote in boldface type, "I'm not paid to lose." Nora's old boyfriend, Kurt, with whom she had worked at the Hollywood firm of Jasperson, Oakes, and Belzer, was featured on the wedding invitation as the groom-to-be. And she recognized the name of his future bride as the actress in the primetime soap opera, Hawk Ridge. She crumpled up the newsletter and with the nail of her middle finger scraped at the embossed names on the invitation before tossing them both into the old dental spit sink that now served as a receptacle for pens and pencils and occasionally a wastebasket. It's not that Nora had wanted a career like Pam's, representing millionaire swindlers and billionaire cheats. And Kurt's obsession with his celebrity clientele, "One day I'll be known as lawyer to the stars," had seemed so childish. But at least they were going after, with a vengeance, what they had always wanted. And now Kurt was getting married to a celebrity. Bonus points. Whereas Nora's calendar didn't even deserve the modifier social, its last entry a coffee date 3 weeks ago. She used to be as much a go-getter as they were. Hadn't she sped through college, raced through law school, earning high grades, prizes, and recommendations? Her current office apparel consisted of faded jeans, a Minnesota North Stars sweatshirt, and a ponytail. But hadn't she once worn designer business suits and severe but flattering chignons? Hadn't she been described as a dynamo, a force to be?
"Bonjour, Nora,"
said Karen Spaeth, after a quick knock announced her presence.
"Ça va?"
"Okay," said Nora, who in her teens had taken one of Karen's classes and remembered enough to answer a simple, "How are you?"
"Je sais que tu es occupé,"
began Karen, who employed the immersion method in her classroom and sometimes forgot that French was not the lingua franca outside of it.
"Excusez-moi. I know you're busy packing up, but do you have time to see my mother?"
Along with handling the business concerns of the etc., Nora's law career also included advising many of the salon's staff and clients on legal matters.
"Sure. What's the problem?"
"Well, she's been getting all these harassing phone calls about magazines she didn't order and..."
"Certainement," said Nora,
wondering what Pam Gregory would think of her thrilling caseload. "Bring her in tomorrow." She left the office early, fairly certain her absence wouldn't tip the scales of justice one way or the other. As she drove home, sleet began to fall, splattering against the windshield in tiny explosions. Nora turned on the wipers, and in their side-to-side rhythm she heard, "Loser, loser, loser." And when she pulled up in front of the original House of Curl on Nawadaha Boulevard, her childhood as well as her adult home, she turned off the car's ignition. Even though the windshield wipers were stilled, the loser refrain was not. The house was quiet. It wasn't yet 3 o'clock, but she turned on the kitchen light, and a yawn of silence answered her query, "Anyone home?" She wandered into the living room with no motive other than deciding where to nap. But a faint tapping redirected her across the room, back through the kitchen, and down the basement steps.
"Hey, Dad," she said, dragging a stool over to the workbench and settling herself next to Thor, who was doing what he most often did, building birdhouses.
Her father interrupted the simple hum that accompanied his carpentry work and smiled.
"Hi, Nora."
"Looks like an airplane hangar, Dad."
"Yeah," said Thor, "'cept for birds."
He resumed hammering a corner of the roof. Sitting next to her father, Nora felt her whole body exhale a sigh of relief, the tension that was a storm inside her evaporating like steam. He hadn't always had this effect on her. When she first met Thor at the age of 14, she could barely look at him without feeling sick, scared, or enraged. His story was sad and strange, and it began several days before Nora's birth, when Thor Rolvaag disappeared. The handsome architecture student had decided it was finally time to RSVP yes to some of the many sexual invitations women offered him. Not all. That would have taken him weeks, months. But he thought diving into the beds of two different women might help him forget his impending paternal responsibilities. It did, briefly. But afterwards, he hadn't reckoned on the guilt that cut through the exuberant taboo of it all, and early dawn found him running home along a snowy river road toward the woman he had betrayed, the woman he loved more than anything, his pregnant wife, Patty Jane. It was fear more than anything that had driven him into these women's beds. He was afraid of the weight of love and its flip side, loss. His own father, Olaf, a Norwegian immigrant, had died when Thor was only 6 years old, and his death had cast a long shadow across his heart. Running home, he vowed to explain all this to Patty Jane and beg for her forgiveness, and if she wasn't willing to grant it, he'd work hour by hour, day by day, to earn her trust again. And he'd be a wonderful father, unafraid to love. The promise made to his bride would never be delivered, because at that moment, Thor leaped over a snowbank. He was an athlete and had no problem clearing it, but he landed on an ice-slicked sidewalk, and from there the athlete was powerless to stop his trajectory. A massive oak tree, however, was not, and Thor made crunching contact with it head first. He was rescued, in a manner of speaking, by a woman named Temple Curry, an oral surgeon whose career had long been shuttered by her mental illness. A near hermit who kept strange hours. Once, a neighbor rushing his laboring wife to the hospital at 2 a.m. had seen Dr. Curry weeding her garden in the moonlight. She had been out sledding in the quiet pink of daybreak and, witnessing Thor's accident, had loaded the prostrate man on her toboggan and towed him to her house across the street. There, in squalor hidden by the home's stately exterior, she kept him prisoner for years. Granted, he was a prisoner who enjoyed occasional field trips, his crazy warden always at his side, and when Temple noticed him taking an interest in the basement woodshop of her deceased father's, she supplied him with enough tools and material to create the birdhouses he seemed compelled to build. Nearly 15 years later, when he was rescued and back at home, Patty Jane had taken him to specialists, but they could not conclude one way or another if the brain injury he had sustained would have been less traumatic had he been treated immediately or differently after his accident. That the House of Curl Salon moved into the large home that Temple Curry bequeathed them after her death was another bizarre, but practical, they did need more room, twist to a story that Nora had learned to synopsize. My dad was gone through my childhood, but he came back. It had taken her years to say and mean, I love you, to her father. But now being in the presence of the gentleman was a tonic, and she was granted the luxury of being no one but herself, knowing Thor loved whatever that self was. So, Dad, she said, watching as he placed the hammer on the work table and surveyed the hangar as carefully as if he were Mr. Boeing inspecting a new facility. I've been in sort of a funk lately. I mean, it's just so weird. No more Patty Jane's House of Curl, etc.? Sure, you can build your birdhouses anywhere, but what am I supposed to do? Open a law office in the dining room? Although now I won't even be booking acts, because there won't be any more acts to book. Continuing his inspection, Thor ran his fingers along the roofline. I mean, I know I should look at this as a new beginning, but a new beginning to what? I don't know what to do. I feel like I'm stuck in a trap I set for myself. Her father folded his hands in his lap and cocked his head as he looked at her. I know what you're thinking, said Nora. If you set the trap, unset it, right? But what if I don't know how? What if I've lost the key? It seems like everyone has the key except for me. No, you have keys, said Thor, his usually placid brow furrowing. Maybe in your purse. Nora smiled. You're right, Dad. They're probably in my purse. Satisfied with his counsel, Thor picked up a block of sandpaper and rubbed it against the roof's edge. Behind the furnace, a load of clothes tumbled in the dryer, and Nora tucked her hand in the crook of her father's elbow. A feeling of calm, not a signature emotion of late, settled in her chest, and as she sat watching him work in a basement that smelled of wood shavings and laundry, she knew what she would do. At least what she would do in the upcoming weekend.
Chapter 4. The appearance of the four elderly bowlers was a source of amusement to the truant high school kids in the next lane, who rolled their eyes and whispered, "This ought to be good," and, "I'm surprised they can even lift the ball," and, "Ooh, looks like someone took their Geritol." Their smirks and derisive comments had vanished by the time Ione rolled her second spare, and when she added a little victory dance after it, they applauded. Ione blew on her fingernails and, polishing them on her chest, said, "I guess I did take my Geritol."
"You tell him,"
whispered Krabby fiercely as Ione sat next to her on the varnished wood bench.
"Ione, that brings you up to 180 with 2 frames to go," said Evelyn Bright, scribbling on the paper score pad.
Minna Shelsky was up next and had been walking toward the ball rack when she stopped abruptly, as if meeting an invisible door. When she turned around, her friends could see the confusion on her face.
"Can I go home now?"
"Don't you want to finish the game?"
asked Krabby. Minna looked as if the question had been asked in a language she didn't speak. She stood frozen as a dark stain blossomed on both sides of her pant legs.
"Oh my God, she's peeing herself," squealed one of the girls in the next lane.
While Ione and Evelyn attended to Minna, Krabby strode over to the high schoolers, grabbing a ball from the rack.
"Why don't you brats pretend you're the pins?" she said, hefting the bowling ball and slapping it with her free hand, "and I'll see if I can roll a strike."
At the etc., there had been a recent trio of lectures on aging. It had peeved Ione to realize the audience had been entirely composed of senior citizens.
"After all," she groused to Patty Jane, "from the time we're born, everybody's aging."
The first lecture, Humor Counts, had been given by a chirpy blonde woman whose gray roots were almost hidden in her champagne-colored hair, and whose jokes Evelyn Bright vaguely remembered from Reader's Digest columns. Move Your Body was the topic of the second lecture, given by a presenter who wore a shiny black tracksuit that matched his lopsided toupee and who proclaimed that 30 daily squats guaranteed a person 10 extra years. A retired engineer running for city council, "I Want to Build a Different Kind of Bridge," gave the third lecture, and he urged his audience of senior citizens to get active, get involved.
"You've got to make your voices heard."
Raising her hand, Krabby asked,
"Even if we do, who wants to listen to a bunch of old bags?"
Still, it was the lecture that most inspired Ione and her friends, and resolving that they had hopes for the future, even if their own were running out, they formed a group dedicated to social action and change and gave themselves the name Old Bags for Change, or OBFC, because, after all, humor counts. Their first planning meeting was to take place in a coffee shop after they'd bowled a few games, Move Your Body, but because of Minna's accident, they decided to reschedule the meeting, date to be determined.
"And probably won't be," thought Ione, so disheartened that once she had gotten home safely, Evelyn drove as if she were trying to qualify for the Indy 500,
she had collected her mail off the table, waved off a Scrabble invitation from Patty Jane, and taken to her room, where she sat on her bed, the contents of her treasure box strewn in front of her. She opened the box once or twice a week to add a letter to a fat, re-ribboned stack, and only occasionally inspected its other items, sometimes when needing aid or comfort, sometimes when desiring a prop to assist her in a walk down memory lane. Or sometimes, she thought, picking up a small bundle, when I want to make a sad mood sadder. Tied inside the blue ribbon was the official documentation of her life and how much loss had occurred in it. Included was her Norwegian birth certificate and her son Thor's American one, her citizenship papers and her marriage license, her husband's death certificate. Seeing the number 34 under age of death still made her gasp. It was the part of her life that wasn't, couldn't be included in that documentation that always made her heart pound, made tears leak out of her blue eyes, and today made her think of the snotty kids at the bowling alley who only saw her as an old lady. Flushing with anger, she whispered, "You have no idea." After she'd calmed her breath, she thumbed through the rest of the bundle, the newspaper obituaries of those she had loved, family members back home, assorted friends from her church circle and the salon, and Harriet and her fiancé, Avil Ames. The thin stack of flattened cereal boxes tied in a wider ribbon also represented sadness. For the man posing on them was her vibrant and impossibly handsome son, Thor, when he was still Thor. He had been talked into product modeling only once by his brother-in-law-to-be, Avil Ames. Heir to a grain fortune, Avil thought a picture of Thor on an Ames Grains cereal box might appeal to housewives at the supermarket. Certainly, Avil had seen in person the effect Thor had on women. It was a savvy business move. The company received many letters ranging from questions like, "Who is that beautiful hunk of manhood?" to promises of brand loyalty. From now on, Mighty Bites is my cereal of choice. Hoarding, let alone wasting, was anathema to Ione's economic way of living. But for the brief time that her missing son's picture was displayed in grocery stores, she couldn't resist buying a box of Mighty Bites every time she shopped, forcing herself to eat the cereal even though she much preferred Wheaties. The fattest beribboned bundle comprised letters, and the feelings they might inspire depended on which letter she chose to read. Some from back home were more than 50 years old. Added to the bundle was the most recent one, the letter she'd received from her grandson. Once, Ava Bunt had pointed out that, of course, because Clyde Chucka was Harry's father, the boy was technically not Ione's grandson. Alva had not been prepared for Ione telling her in no uncertain terms what she could do with her technicalities. Just as Ione had been a constant presence in her granddaughter Nora's life, so was she in Harry's, until he had left to go to boarding school. Thankfully, Harry liked to write letters, and he and Ione enjoyed a prolific correspondence. She reread the letter that had been waiting for her on the hall table. "Dear Grandma, I was kind of down today, maybe because I talked to Nora last night and her bad mood spread, making me wonder why I thought it was so important to go to Braddock. Like, why aren't I at home with all of you, helping you close down the etc.? Why aren't I going to a normal school with all of my old friends? Why aren't I playing hockey with guys I've played with for years?
Why did I leave Rebecca Olson? Not that she was my girlfriend, but she might have been if I stayed.
Why? Existential crisis much? But today in band class, a really cool thing happened. There's this guy, Ethan. There are like 20 Ethans here, and even though Harry is kind of a weird name, at least there aren't 20 more of them. Anyway, Ethan's like a majorly good musician, but also a real jerk. There's also this guy, Caleb, only 3 Calebs around, who's just as good, but in a different way. He can't read music, but he can play anything by ear. Like, if he hears a song once, he sits down at the piano and plays it. But Ethan says he's not a real musician, that he's lazy and cheating, and this guy Caleb, oh man, that really hurts him. Anyway, the band teacher, Mr. Archer, is pretty cool, and he knew all this stuff was going on between them, and so today he says he has some Beatles sheet music and asks Ethan to play it, which he did, and he played it great. Then he hands the music to Caleb, and Caleb sits there at the piano and says, "You know I can't read music." And Mr. Archer says, "Yeah, but can you play it?" And Caleb says, "Sure." And plays Hey Jude like he wrote the song himself. I mean, it was like, wow. Then Mr. Archer asks if either of them knows the Rolling Stones song, Lady Jane, and both of them say no. Although I did, Grandma, musical historian that I am. So he's got the song queued up in his tape deck and plays it for the class and afterwards asks Ethan to play it. And he says, "Sure, where's the music?" And Mr. Archer says he doesn't have it. And Ethan says, "Well, then I can't play it." But Caleb could. And Grandma, it was sweet. He only heard the song once, but it's like it went from his ears into his fingers. I'm not bad at playing by ear, but man, I could never do what Caleb did. It's just so weird, like those people who do really complicated math equations in their heads, kind of like a gift, you know? Speaking of gifts, Dad sent me some great Clash, a great, unfortunately disbanded band, t-shirts from London, and like everybody in school wants to buy them. I could make some serious cash. But they're so cool, I'd never sell them. All for now. Love you, Harry. P.S. Ava, almost as cute as Rebecca Olson, said she'd go to winter snow dance with me. Her long-standing habit had been to answer a letter the day she received it, as it seemed more of a conversation. But with the emotions of the day swaddling her in torpor, what would she write? "Yeah, I too am down today, wondering what I am doing. If I have any value anymore. If I'll ever get over not being what I wanted to be. Existential crisis much?" "Oh, stop it," she scolded herself, getting up to fetch some stationery. She couldn't let her mood get in the way of the business at hand. First, she'd peel the potatoes for dinner, and while they were boiling, she'd sit down and write Harry a good grandmotherly letter, one that wouldn't scare him. Chapter 5. Studying a map of state parks, Nora debated between one near the North Shore or another near Brainerd, and chose the latter, preferring, especially in winter weather, the much closer drive. Ione had given her a sack of freshly baked gingerbread cookies for the road, and Nora had set off excited, but a wrong turn around a big lake had put her on a road that forced her around a bigger lake. Instead of backtracking, she continued on, hoping that by sheer force of will she would find the right county road sign. "Why didn't I leave earlier?" she muttered. Being lost in daylight was one thing, but being lost in the waning light of a December afternoon was another thing entirely. Passing the hump of a deer carcass on the side of the road, Nora's body tensed, expecting that at any moment another leaping antlered animal would choose the wrong time to cross the road. She punched the radio buttons, but within seconds an energetic refrain of an old Doobie Brothers song gurgled into static. Beyond the tall pines on the left loomed the lake with the apparently unending circumference, and from the tall pines on the right, something sprang out. Nora gasped and braked hard, and it took her a moment to realize that what she had almost turned into roadkill was not a deer but a human being. Covered up as it was hard to discern the sex of the small figure waving its arms, and when the small figure opened the passenger door, Nora's first thought was that a man was hijacking her car, or worse. "Give me a lift." It was an order rather than a request, but Nora was relieved the voice giving it was more a soprano than a bass. Before she could answer, "Sure, hop in," the woman had. "Dang boots!" Stumped for a response, Nora sat for a long moment until her passenger, after setting her canvas musette bag at her side and clicking her seatbelt buckle, said, "Well, come on then, let's go." On the drive, the woman who had a pronounced New York accent and whose face, under her fluorescent orange stocking cap, was lined with frowns, explained that she was walking home after doing business in town. "Town?" asked Nora.
"Charleville."
Jerking her mittened thumb over her shoulder, she added, "About 3 miles that away."
"You walked there?"
"No, I skipped, then I cartwheeled."
"You seem sort of upset."
"Well, aren't you perceptive?" said the woman. Shaking her head, she made a dismissive "tuh" sound and muttered something about only wanting a ride and not the third degree. Nora was tempted to mutter words of her own, but took the high road, literally if not figuratively, when the woman shouted,
"Turn up here! Take a right!"
was the next directive, and Nora turned off the road lined with a sentry of fir trees and into a long driveway.
"Stop here," said the woman. "Do you plan to plow into the garage?"
Unbuckling her seatbelt, she opened the door and plunged out of the car with the instructions, "Bring my bag."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.